In our last lecture, we defined the energy per unit length, which had the gradient of the elemental potential in it, and then we defined the gradient of the elemental potential as being the sum of the node voltages times the gradient of the shape function. Well, let's look at one of those shape functions. Alpha 1 is 1 over 2a times a1 plus b1x plus c1y. If we take its gradient, this is what we're going to end up with, and you can see that that is just a function of the size, shape, and location of the triangle. Its node locations, x1, y1, x2, y2, and so on. So now let's use that to define the energy per unit length. All we're going to do is take this value and substitute it in up here. That's going to give us the elemental energy being 1/2 the integral of the sum from I equals 1 to 3 of VEI times the gradient of alpha I squared ds. Well, now let's break that up into two parts, because that's going to make it easier for us to analyze. And that's going to be the sum from I equals 3 VEI gradient of alpha I, sum of j equals 1 to 3 VEJ gradient of alpha j DSE. Now let's look what can be integrated. What is constant here? Well, our node potentials are constant, so certainly they can come outside of this integral. Our shape functions and their gradients are not constant, so they're going to have to stay inside the integral. And let's also assume that the dielectric constant stays constant within each element, not necessarily within the whole model, but within each element, so it can come outside too. So that gives us an elemental energy that looks like this. 1/2, and then a double summation, I equals 1 to 3, j equals 1 to 3, and let's put epsilon right here, outside of all of that, times VEI, and then we're going to have this integral, gradient of alpha I, dotted with gradient of alpha j, integrated over the element, multiplied by VEJ. This thing right here, we're going to call CIJ for the element, and that is the elemental coefficient matrix. Sometimes it's also called the elemental coupling matrix, because the coupling between each of the nodes is modeled by this elemental coupling matrix. Now we know what each of the gradients are, so we know that we could dot them, and in fact we could integrate them. So let's consider, for example, C11 for the given element. So that's going to be the integral of the gradient of alpha 1 dotted with itself, gradient of alpha 1 integrated over the element. Well, that's going to be 1 over 4a squared times y2 minus y3 squared plus x3 minus x2 squared integrated over the surface of the element. Well, there's nothing varying in here over that element. Those are set points. So this integral simply becomes the area of the element, which, in fact, is the same thing that shows up here. So this is going to be 1 over 4a times y2 minus y3 squared plus x3 minus x2 squared. And that's going to be our C11 for this particular element. Now we can go through and do the same thing for C12, C13, C21, C22, and so on, and that will give us our full elemental coefficient matrix. Then, if we write C for the element as C11, C12, C13, 21, 22, 23, 31, 32, 33, that's our elemental coefficient matrix, or our elemental coupling matrix. And let's write our elemental node vector. That's VE1, VE2, and VE3. Put those all together to find the elemental energy, which is 1/2 times epsilon in the element times VE transposed times C times VE. The next thing that we're going to do is find out what we should do when we have more than one element. So we've been able to define everything so far just for a single element.